we played a jazz festival somewhere. Ruby Braff, the great, great cornet player. Ruby was very outspoken, as you remember.
Yes.
He didn't suffer fools lightly, as the saying goes.
That's and a very wonderful way of saying it.
He would tell it like it was.
Mm-hmm.
And we were playing some too. And it just got, nobody knew where anybody was. It was hysterical. Somehow, we finished the tune. And the audience is applauding, and Ruby turns to the guys on the bandstand and says, anybody get hurt?
Yes, we're traumatized and we'll never play this tune again.
Oh, and we never did.
Kind of reminds me a little bit of Jay Canna said that he was on a gig with Warren and Rosie Clooney. And Warren was having some kind of problem of some sort. And Rosie called Be Careful, It's My Heart, you know, from Holiday Inn that Bing used to sing.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't remember who Jake said was on the bass, but Rosie would start it with Be Careful, and then Warren was supposed to fill in some windows, and then she'd start singing the rest, and then the rhythm section would follow. Well, she would sing Be Careful, and Warren dropped the mute. And so she got her, you know, that Rosie kind of look, you know, and started it over again. So she sings Be Careful, and Warren's music comes tumbling down. And now Rosie's got quite a look on her face. And so all of a sudden from Jake, you hear, she told you to be careful. And after that, she could not do that tune on the road because she was crying laughing.
Oh, Jake Hanna. Oh, bless his heart. One of the greatest of all time. We could do a half hour on just his wit and wisdom alone.
Oh, yeah, that's for sure.
Some of the Jake Hanna stories.
A whole holding court in musicians' lounges were a whole experience in of itself.
I saw him reduce Ralph Sutton to tears one night laughing. Ralph was in a dark mood for some reason. He'd done a set and he was in a dark mood. We went back to the green room where we were sitting there. And I'm sitting and Ralph is like off to my right. Jake is on my left. And then all of a sudden, Jake hears some music. And there's a boom box somewhere playing some music in the background. He gets up and he goes over and he turns it up. Then he comes back to the middle of the room and he starts dancing like an idiot. I mean, his stomach is bouncing up and down, and he's waving his hips around, and he's doing hey, the jive. Pretty soon, Ralph Sutton is crying. He's laughing so hard. He's almost falling out of the chair onto the floor. And it was that was the whole idea. Jake wanted to get his friend out of the gloom and make him laugh.
And he's just dancing
like an idiot. It's one of the funniest, most beautiful things I ever saw. But Hannah was like that.
Yeah,
he could take a situation and turn it totally around immediately.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I was running a festival in Monterey at one point or another, and I was just stressed beyond the limit, lack of sleep, and everybody calling and, you know, complaining or needing or forgetting something. And Jake saw me walking up and he goes, sit down. And I went, Jake, I gotta sit down. And I sat down and he just kind of just stared, didn't say a word. And then he goes, okay, I think you've been breathing enough. Now you go do what you need to do. He just wanted me to stop and calm down and breathe and before I went on. So it was just a very sweet person like that. But one other person that I remember having kind of gone off about you and, of course, you're playing was John Hendricks. He and Annie Ross had a gig down here in Carmel.
Oh, yes.
And we went out to eat afterwards, and he was trying to figure out why on earth me, as a young 20s person at that point in time, could possibly have any care of this music at all and why. So he was very asking me a whole bunch of questions, just peppering me. How did I grow up? How did I get in this? How did I da 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 da? And so I started mentioning the first time I met Saunders with Wild Bill, and that you were in the band with probably Isla or Dave Stone or somebody. and Johnny Varro, and he goes, Butch, you know, and I can say this because I know he said this in liner notes that he wrote, and so I can say this without getting in trouble. He said, some cats couldn't swing if you hung them. Oh. And he goes, Butch, he could swing anything.
Oh, that's so sweet. That's so nice.
Yes, it is nice. And he just had this very stern face on him when he first started that sentence. Some people couldn't swing if you hung him. And I thought, oh, am I going to have a fight with you? Because if you're going to say something bad about Butch, we're going to have words.
I loved him. He was so great. We didn't have a chance to hang out very much at all times, but there were times when the Basie band would do something and John would be a special guest.
Yeah.
And he'd come out and do two or three tunes. And boy, he just would tear it.
Oh,
up.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
The band would just jump to another level. It's John Henry, Count Basie.
Mm. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Better.
Oh, never. Yeah. And he loved Basie so much. I mean, how could he not? If he's going through the effort of turning every Basie chart note for note into vocalese, I mean, you got to love Basie a whole heck of a lot. And I only wish I was a fly on a wall for that one to have seen him sing with Basie. When you guys, that would have been something to see.
It was great. I never had the opportunity to work with Lambert, Hendricks, and Rawls.
Yeah. Because
they died before I ever had a chance to do that. But I knew Annie.
Yeah.
And she was great. One night, I was living in Westchester County. It's just a little north of New York City. And there was a gentleman who had a nightclub down in Yonkers. And Al DeFemio was his name. And he also played some drums and he owned the club. And he brought in jazz every weekend. I mean, he'd bring in Zoot Sims. He'd bring in Clark Terry, Scotty Hamilton, all kinds of people. And this is like a 15-minute drive from my house. So I'd find out who's playing that weekend. We drive down and go in. And more often than not, some things would happen. I remember one night Al ran out. Clark was getting ready to start the set. And Al ran out. I mean, it wasn't Clark. It was Al Cohn was playing there that night. And so DeFemio ran out and he says, look, Al, man, we got a problem in the kitchen. He said, I can't do the first set. He said, go ahead and start and just do it with the piano and the bass. And I'll catch up when I can. And he runs away. And Al turns to me and looks at me, you know, with that the one eye, really.
Yeah.
And he says in that inimitable voice, he says, so you want to sit in? So I wound up playing the first set. And I would do that some when Clark was there, Zoot was there. And one night I was doing that. I was sitting in and Annie Ross comes in the place. And Annie sees me and she sees Clark. She sees all the guys and she jumps up. Nobody's going to stop her. And she starts and it just took off. She goes into going to Chicago.
Uh-huh.
Remember their version. So I'm singing the backgrounds. My time is your time. Yeah. The whole thing. And we're having a ball.
It sounds like it. I remember asking her, how on earth can you do Twisted after a few drinks? I just don't understand. My tongue can't even talk right after coffee. I don't even understand. And she goes, lots of practice. Okay.
She would kill me with that tune. I mean, right out of her mouth, you know, my analyst told me, and I'm on the floor because I know what's coming.
Yeah.
Oh, she was so great. One time we were in England with the band, the Basie band, and Annie invited everybody over. Sarah Vaughn was with us traveling around, and she invited everybody over to her place for a chili afternoon dinner. They were going to make chili and cornbread and all kinds of stuff. So you get Annie, you get Sass, Sarah Vaughn, nickname Sassy, and a couple of other people, and they're cooking for the Basie band. And we're having a party. I remember it so beautifully. She had a place just off of name drop Abbey Road.
Yeah.
Exactly. And
not name dropping if it's true.
it was true, and it was great. I'm thinking Annie Ross and Sarah Vaughn are making chili for the Count Basie band. Oh, man.
And cool.
You can't put that in Palm Beach.
No.
Nobody would believe it.
Well, it's like I was talking the other day with somebody after Charlie Watts died. I said, I was at Jake's house having, speaking of chili and hot dogs, and everybody's hanging out, and this older English gentleman sits down, and we're talking away. We're talking Basie. We're talking Goodman. We're talking Glenn Miller. We're talking Peanut Tucko. We're talking, you know, jabbering away, having a grand old time, and he gets up to get some more chili or go to the bathroom or get a drink. I don't know. It doesn't matter. Somebody came up and said, do you know who you've been talking to? And I went, a nice guy? I don't know. And he said, that's Charlie Watts. And me, growing up with all these guys, I'm just like, dude, I don't, no recognition. And they went, April, it's the Stones drummer. Oh, what's he doing at Jake's? I don't understand. Then I found out he loves Jake. Yeah. So it's stuff like you said, nobody else would believe because they go, no way, no. Can't happen.
Jake said that the Charlie would come into town. And he'd call Jake up, and Jake would get in the car and go over and get him.
Yeah.
And he'd take me back to the house, and they'd have chili and watch football.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Charlie?
Uh-huh.
I went backstage. My wife, Linda, and I went to a Stones concert a number of years ago in Houston. Uh-huh. And we got backstage passes. Charlie and the Stones office, they were so kind.
Yeah.
And we go back, and I'm hanging with the backup band. I know half the cats anyway.
Yeah.
And then Charlie comes in. And I introduce him to my wife and my wife to Charlie and everything. And we sit down for maybe about 10 or 15 minutes before he's got to prep and get ready to go on stage. Nothing about any of the albums, not about any of this, not any about that. He wants to talk about jazz and the musicians and the guys we all know together, like and people like that. Delightful, wonderful, lovely man. Mm-hmm. And then 2 days after the show, my phone rings. And I pick it up and say, hello, hello. And there's nobody there. So connection's broken. And I hang it up and I had caller ID and I looked and it said Rolling Stones. It didn't see AT&T or anything. It said Rolling Stones. Oh, I know who this is. I had Charlie's number. So I call him back and I get a hold of him. And we chatted for about another 5 or 10 minutes. He had had so much fun at the show and we had so much fun at the show. They were just being the Stones and he was just doing what he did.
Yeah.
Play with the greatest rock and roll band in the world. But all that night, all he wanted to talk about was jazz.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's the same. Like I said, I would never have known anything because we didn't say anything about Stones, Beatles, nothing. We didn't go through any of that inflammatory stuff. It was all talking about, like you say, just he just loved it so much and was just so happy to talk to somebody else who knew it and loved it and didn't really make a big fuss about him. He was just, this is great kind of thing. But
About jazz has got, you're so lucky to have had all of this background and know so many of these people from such a young age. Now here's a story for you also, talking about a lot of the jazz musicians who love a lot of the rockers, which I do, and a lot of the rockers who love the jazz musicians.
Yeah.
And I was with Basie the first time, we were playing Montreux, Switzerland, the great Montreux Jazz Festival there on the lake in Switzerland. It's beautiful. And we're playing the gig that night and we're just wailing. And we finish up and we go backstage and we're in the musician's room back there, resting and relaxing. And someone says, hey man, you know who was here tonight? I said, no. And he said, man, Led Zeppelin was here.
Oh yeah.
We're sitting up in the press boxes so that nobody knew that they were there. I said, really? He says, yeah. Oh man, look who just came in the door. I said, who, what? He says, John Bonham. John Bonham is here. I said, oh, wow. So we got together and he and I had a chance to talk for a couple of minutes and had a very wonderful photograph taken together.
Oh, that's nice.
Charlie and I never did that, but I did with John Bonham that one night. Yeah. He was a huge jazz fan.
Oh, yeah. Guys, I didn't know that.
It was wonderful. It was so nice. We should get some common ground for a minute.
Yeah. Well, I know Paul McCartney really appreciates jazz and the whole background and everything too. And I think actually the last album that Dave Stone recorded was with him, if I remember correctly.
I think so. And one of those albums, he had the Sir McCartney had both Bucky and John Pizzarelli.
Oh, I didn't know that. I hadn't heard that one. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So he has such an appreciation of it, you know, and they have the background and the chops and, you know, they don't look their noses down because they make more money than most jazz musicians in existence.
And in the end, the love you take is equal to the love you make.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not so much the money that you make, but it's
Bill was always, while Bill was always so upset that in Europe, people, jazz musicians could make a living much easier than they could in this country. And, you know, jazz really started here, and that used to just burn him up that he he had to go to Denmark and live there for a while because he couldn't make it as a full-time musician in America where he was born. So and he also would go off a lot on the fact that American audiences were so rude compared to those in Europe or England. They would be so respectful while listening to it and not talk over it and not get in fights over it and, you know, or over the music playing, that they were very respectful. Have you found that a lot as well, that kind of similar experiences?
Yep, exactly. I've been approached, and other people that I've known, those other great jazz musicians, I've been approached on the streets in Japan. Mm-hmm. By groups 2, 3, 4, 5 people at the same time wanting autographs, and they know basically everything you've ever recorded, or every TV show you've ever done, or every band you've ever worked with. These people are serious. They love it.
Yeah,
they just absolutely love it. And the French, the Germans, just all over Europe, everywhere I've gone, everywhere, I can't say everywhere, I'm sorry, let me take that back.
Most everywhere.
Everywhere that I've gone outside of the United States has an appreciation of jazz and music as a whole that is far superior to ours. And I've often put that down to the use it and lose it and get something else immediately. Type of consideration that the Americans, the United States, that we have here. You want it, as Mule used to say, as Major Holly used to say, he says, I want it all and I want it now. And unfortunately, that's the way a lot of us think. I want it all and I want it now. I turn the TV on. What's wrong with the TV? It's not working. How dare they? Come on, man.
Or then it reminds you, once you get what you want, you don't want it at all. Yeah. So then, I had it. So now I'm off to something else. It's just kind of
be careful what you wish for.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Well, and it kind of reminds me a little bit. Lena Horne used to say that she would hate performing in some of the clubs in the U.S. just because of the rude way that people would just talk during ballads and, you know, just like argue with one another on the top of their voices. Whereas if she was out in a club in Germany or England or France, that they were just so kind and respectful. But you worked with Lena too, didn't you?
Sure did. Oh, I loved her.
I did too.
Well, I'm looking at a photo, right? I don't know. Let me see if I can turn this around.
Yeah.
Here's my, and I don't have a picture up on my screen right now. Can you see this?
I can. Oh, look at her. Oh, I miss that lady. I love that picture.
That was taken in Stockholm. We were going to do a week of shows, and I had just gotten off the plane a few hours early, gone to the hotel, and then I'd gone to the rehearsal.
Uh-huh. We were
getting ready to rehearse. I was exhausted out of my bird. I didn't know where I was. But someone said, can we get a shot of you two? And I said, yeah. And I grabbed her and hugged her, which I normally wouldn't have done. But I just adored her, and she was so beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And I got that shot, and I've kept it for so long.
Good for you.
I've loved working with Lena. Oh,
yeah. I love that sense of humor. And man, she could burn up a stage just with a look. I mean, she had that presence where she could just, it was, somebody said once that she was the only female they ever knew that could swagger.
Ah, that's great. Do you ever remember when she would really sing a song and she was really digging, trying to get into the audience? She'd start to bend over, and I told her sometimes she would start to walk like a tigress.
Exactly.
Black Panther, and she'd bend down and that backward arch, you know.
Yep. Woo. Yep. Oh, it was just like, watch out, you better not cross me.
I have another photograph that she gave me, a PR photo. Many years ago, we were doing a show, and she said something about my playing to somebody, and I said, well, it's not bad for a white boy, is it? I could get away with some of this, because it was, I'm not even going to go into it. And she looked at me, and she said, in that beautiful voice, she said, well, honey, if Basie is your father and I'm your voodoo mama, what does that make you? So I've got a photo downstairs of Lena, a PR photo, saying, "To Butch, much love from your voodoo mama, Lena."
That sounds like her, man.